Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I cordially welcome all of you for the knowledge sharing session that is hosted by GASL within this 50th anniversary. Right? So now GASL, which was started in 1970, that means about 50 years ago, now almost completed 50 years. This is 50th anniversary year of Golden Jubilee. So we have identified during this pandemic time to have some online session for the our members and for the general public. Because you know, the basic vision of Gemologists Association is to educate people regarding gemological sciences. In that concept, we have thought of having knowledge sharing sessions, and as the first step of this knowledge sharing sessions, we are having some interesting topic. That means related to Gajamuthu and the Valampuri, right? Or the elephant ivory and the concepts, Valampuri concepts. Because a lot of rumors of things are circulating within the society about this thing. So in this exercise, I am very much gladful Mr. Samantha Gunasekara came ahead to make this event practical, or to make have this event. Now, in the organization, in the case of organizing this event, I have to thank especially Mr. Samita Lienakit, the General Secretary, who is very enthusiastic regarding this. And even Mr. Rusiru Dolalivud, Mr. Man Balagi, and our other expo members, they were very committed to make this kind of session for the general public. So without wasting your valuable time, I am handing over the session to Mr. Man Balagi to make introductory remarks regarding our presenter about Mr. Samantha Gunasekara. So it's the time for Nuan.
Good evening, everybody. I am honored here to introduce our eminent speaker. Thank you, EXCO. Today we are going to have a very interesting topic, Gajamuthu and Valampuri, truth and myth, how not to get caught. I would like to present you a brief introduction about the speaker. Samantha Gunasekara is the immediate past president of Gemologists Association of Sri Lanka. Worked as a deputy director of customs, his last position was director of biodiversity, society's 18th conference of the parties, Sri Lankan secretariat. He is a scientist, researcher, and environmentalist, wildlife photographer, writer, a social worker. Presently, he has engaged as an ambassador for United Nations Drugs and Crimes Office in New York and Austria on anti-corruption in wildlife crimes. He is science graduate of University of Sri Lanka and has master's degree in wildlife trade with PhD reading process, both from the prestigious International University of Andalusia, Spain. He is qualified as gemologist from Great Britain, that's FGA, Germany FGG, diamond expert Germany, Diploma in Gemology from University of Morotur. He has served customs and has obtained experience in wildlife detections, investigation and prosecution over 3 decades, created the world's first customs biodiversity protection unit and biodiversity protection task force, which is responsible for several hundred detections in protecting Sri Lankan natural and cultural heritage. Concept and creation of Sri Lanka Customs Museum is another national level achievement. Further to that, he has served 9 years as a gem appraiser in Customs Gem Unit. His service in the protection of the environment of Sri Lanka has been recognized by over 50 national environmental awards, including first presidential environmental award, and the latest recognition is the public servant award of the other Dherana Sri Lankan of the year 2018. He is the author of monograph on export trade of indigenous freshwater fishes of Sri Lanka, Jaiva Mangoleta Erehiva, Nearly Lost, and several scientific and general publications on wild orchids and freshwater fish species, gene piracy, wildlife trade, etc. Mr. Gunasekara is a resource person to Sri Lanka Customs Human Resource Division and many ministries, governments, departments, NGOs, international organizations, and a visiting lecturer of many universities on the subjects of gemology, biodiversity, fauna and flora, archaeology, cultural heritage. And I hope this session would be a remarkable to you. Thank you very much. Mr. Samantha Gunasekara, floor is over to you right now.
Good morning to everybody. Thank you, Mr. Rohan, our president DSL, for giving me this opportunity to. And also, Mr. Noan, for introducing me very elaborately. Thank you all. And also, I'm very delighted to have this presentation, because this is a special topic. What I'm going to talk is something very special. Normally, we don't talk this topic. Generally, we don't hear this topic, as many people who just talk on this subject, they are generally we talk, but fact finding based on the scientific facts is very rarely we talk. Therefore, based on the facts and the scientific background on this issue is very important. That's why I said it's very important and very unique. So we don't get this generally. We don't get this lecture another time. So it's my topic: Gajamuthu and Valampuri, truth and myth. How not to get caught? So you will have to know what are those two objects, and in future not to get caught and not to get many publicity and the Asian countries on the subject matter, and some people get trouble because of myths and wrong facts. So the methodology which I use is basically literature available, books, and also many media publications. And also I have examined many specimens throughout the world, many museums, especially National Museum in Sri Lanka. All the specimens I have examined and tested, and also customs collections. There are many objects in the religious places, kovils, temples and all. And also there are private properties. There are certain people who hold this in private properties, and also personal communication. I have interviewed many gemologists and also veterinary elephant owners, mahouts, wildlife experts, Buddhist monks, you know, the dealers, traders, and treasure hunters as well, looters, media personnel, subject experts, various people. And also, basically, I think at the introduction, Mr. Noan mentioned about my experience and the qualifications on the wildlife trade. So my experience through over 3 decades of experience on the subject matter, and also my qualification on the wildlife trade, the mass all postgraduate studies, and also field knowledge. From my small days, I'm attached to the wildlife and the environment. So I have experience. So all blended with these materials and the information, I have came to this presentation. That's what it is important for you to know, because generally this is a subject people do not hear or talk generally. So first of all, we'll have to get a proper idea about what the ivory is. You know, ivory is scientifically we have to know what the ivory is. Actually, ivory is a trade name. trade name, but in Sri Lanka, in Sinhalese word, we talk Addala. Addala means only the elephant tusks. But ivory means a trade name. That is, scientifically, it is a tooth or tusk of a mammal, any mammal, which is the dentine of the mammal. And also, which is capable for a commercial carving. Capable enough to do a commercial carving, which produced by the odontoblastic cells. So, this secreted from the odontoblastic cells, so it deposited as dentinal tubules, about 0.8 to 2.2 microns, very minute tubules, deposited layers and layers over and over, so produced the tusk. So the chemical composition is the calcium phosphate, calcium hexophosphate carbonate, hexophosphate carbonate, including water. So that is very hard material, very, very hard. And the tusk, when you see an animal, so only half of the tusk we will able to see. Another half inside the body. So you will see the structure of the elephant head and realize that. So this is the ivory. So we'll have to get, should get the basic knowledge of the ivory to come through the item. So as I mentioned before, there are many mammals which produce the ivory. So according to that definition, African elephants, mammoth, walrus teeth and tusk both, sperm whale, all teeth, narwhal whale incisors, hippopotamus canines, and also upper and lower incisors, and warthog. There's another animal similar to a big wild boar in Africa, that warthog, upper and lower canines also considered as ivory. So which are capable to do any commercial carving, a carving from this material. So general idea of ivory, generally in Asian countries, especially in Sri Lanka, we talk ivory means the elephant ivory. Because other ivories, it is not very common in Sri Lanka, very rarely. I saw in examining the museum specimens, some Gajamuthu specimens in the Colombo Museum, I got some foreign materials as well. They are not elephant ivory, some hippopotamus teeth, and also some mammoth parts where they are among the Gajamuthu in the Colombo National Museums. So the elephant means upper incisors of Elephas maximus is the Asian elephant, and Loxodonta africana, African elephant, and Mammothus. Praegomyganus is the mammoth, which is the extinct animal long time back. It is important now the scientists have spaced out the ivory trade in, and also especially China, those Asian countries, they agreed to phase out the ivory trade from 2018 January. Now the mammoth ivory is in trade. Even in Sri Lanka, there are more and more specimens found with foreign tourists now. Therefore, it is important to know these subjects and these specimens are available in Sri Lanka. So the very distinct or constant thing is the ivory is the shragalines. It's called engine head turns, or Schrager lines, or the Retzius lines. So these lines are very distinct and very particular. It depends for the elephant ivory. So it can be measured. So you can photocopy a specimen, keep on the photocopy machine and enlarge, and you can measure the angle. This angle is always over 150 degrees. 120, 21. Sometimes if you take about 4-5 measurements and take the average, you get over 115. Is definitely elephant. This is very constant and definite method of identification of elephant ivory. If it is mammoth, it is less than 90 degrees. There are many other UV tests. It is not very sure. Chemical tests are there. Other than all the tests, this angle is very, very distinct. Even many substitutes, artificial products, none of those products can imitate the correct angle of the elephant or mammoth ivory. Therefore, it is a very distinct and acceptable method of identification. And this presence, you know, this ivory, mammoth ivory, the presence are brownish color, these things also there. But very distinct is the angle of the ivory. So this structure, I said, is minute, micron 0.2 to 0.9, 0.9 to 2.2 microns, layers and layers. So deposited, and that particular structure, this layers and several layers of this ivory substance, calcium phosphate substance, sometimes the structure can be visible. This is several layers. So even this structure visible to the naked eye, this structure can be seen. This is a piece of the ivory which destructed in Colombo in 2016, January, Customs Day. So 359 elephant tusks were destroyed in public. So you can see the structure. Even to the naked eye, the several thickness layers. So the structure there. So this is very important for you to get an idea about the elephant head. So the structure is very, very important because to identify the things, you will have to know the structure. So this is the tusk of an elephant. It is very, very similar to humans. Very, very same structure, but different formation. Same structure to common to all mammals. So this is the elongated one, and this is the you can see the enamel that is only at the tip. Even humans, you can see the white part of our teeth, that is the enamel. So elephants having only at the tip, or the only thin layer outside, sometimes worn out, the white part, the enamel. So the dentin is the material, is the center full of dentin. And the base is the pulp cavity. So having the knowledge of the pulp cavity, it is very important when you talk about the elephant ivory or the elephant pearl, gajamuthu. Because this pulp cavity, actually the pulp cavity is full of pulp gel. When the animal is in living, so the pulp cavity is full of material of pulp gel as well as capillary, blood capillaries, nerves, and all these are full of this, filled with this, you know, the pulp cavity. Therefore, it is not an empty case. The empty cavity, you see only the dead tusks, dead elephants. Because when the pulp gel and the blood capillaries and all these removed, you will see the pulp cavity. So this is how the story of this tumbling of the pieces get started. The story is seeing this cavity. But actually when the animal is living, you don't get an empty cavity. That is very, very important to know this subject. I think you got that idea. So the gajamuthu is the term in Sri Lanka, what I am going to talk today. That is gajamuthu. It's well known among literature and very old literature also it comes. But the thing is, this gajamuthu story, in India it is gajamukta. Gajamukta. That is, in India also, in certain part of India it's available. The dog. But it is important, but similar to Sri Lanka, there are many other countries in Asia Myanmar, Thailand, Cambodia. With those countries, elephants also living with harmony. Elephants and the humans, they are very close to their culture, similar to Sri Lanka, very close to their culture. But the story is not these countries. Gajamukta or Gajamutu, in certain part of India, especially in Kerala and area, and Sri Lanka. But there are many African countries who poach thousands and thousands of elephants for ivory. But in those countries, the Gajamukta or the elephant pearl story is not available. And they have not been rich out of this Gajamukta. So, examining the specimens, actually earlier days, sometimes back, earlier many specimens actually, I have seen, I have examined, and I come to a conclusion, many of them were other objects like white quartz, rose quartz, and also wooden pieces, tumbled wooden pieces, bone, many structures. Were different materials were produced earlier in Sri Lanka. But nowadays, I think I have examined many specimens from, you know, the treasure hunting, Nidhane, on many places, from temples and so many stories. But many of those materials are not ivory. They are other materials like quartz, bone, animal bone or something tumbled and tamed to some spherical shape. But that except Gajamutu what is selling, and nowadays there are two types of specimens we can differentiate. So first type is the pearl appearance. If we come to this slide, this Webster James book is well known among the gemologists. It's like Bible of the gemologist. So there it has mentioned, Webster, Anderson has mentioned, concentric layers of dentine are sometimes deposited on and around some foreign body which has entered the pulp cavity of an elephant, thus forming a more or less spherical based or pearl-like appearance. Little is known about the structure of these curious objects, which are known in Sri Lanka as elephant pearl, and held in high and somewhat superstitious esteem. This is the Webster book states. So there it says pearly appearance. But you know, as gemologists, you know the secretion of creation to produce the pearl-like material, there should be a layer, should be secreted by some cells. In pearls, they have, you know, conchoidal material, and this carbonate, calcium, crystals of calcium carbonate or another material is deposited over and over, layers and layers produce the pearl. But the elephants do not possess such nacreous layer or around the pulp cavity or other similar cells other than this odontoblastic cells which produce the calcium phosphate material. So in that case, the pearly appearance and the calcium phosphate secretion through the odontoblastic cells are very two different ways. Therefore, it cannot, if it is secreted from odontoblastic cells, it is not the odontoblastic cell, it is cannot produce the pearl appearance. It is my knowledge and that my examination proved that it is produced by the available cells in an elephant. So therefore it is doubt how the pearl appearance, because the examination, I have examined the Bodhi Amarasinghe's museum in Ratnapura, that is, it was pearl appearance. I saw that it is in 20-25 years back, it was metallic, you know, the hematite color, exactly hematite appearance. And later, about 10-15 years back, it was brownish. I saw that specimen. And other specimen I examined from Mathale, about several hundred years old, that is also a pearl appearance. So that is different substances, but it is very unlikely to produce such material from an elephant. So those specimens are there. So the second category, odontoblastic cells. Other than that, the second category, which this is the same one, the second category is that ivory appearance. So this is more possible than the earlier specimens and the earlier group. This type is a piece of ivory or part of the ivory or a secretion from the same odontoblastic cells and released into the pulp cavity of the elephant and produce the elephant fur. But I have mentioned at the beginning, seeing the structure of the elephant, I clearly explained that this is not empty. As many people think, this is empty. The live elephant always is full of material. Therefore, it is unlikely to produce a tumbling process and produce a stone or something by a tumbling process. Okay? Then that is very important. And also, according to the Indian literature, very rarely the elephants live long, about 125 years, so they produce. But very rarely in Sri Lanka, I have talked to some doctors, medical veterinary doctors in Sri Lanka, who had examined hundreds of elephant postmortems. Only one case been examined, about 75-year-old elephant, which had a natural death in Osgamoa, had a small cavity because that material, the pulp cavity gets shrink after a long time. It's a well matured elephant, only get that, but it had no elephant pearls, but at a small cavity, otherwise it is full. So very rare cases, generally elephant should be naturally old, get old for that to produce that cavity. And also, I have seen some in Gangaram. You can see some African, so small blisters or button-like formation within the elephant, surrounding the pulp cavity, small button-like formation also can be seen very rarely cases. So to fulfill the fulfillment of the cavity, formation of the cavity, about 7500 years old elephant, and a small piece or some material get tumbled within that, and it takes another several decades to formation something. To fulfill all these two things is a very rare case. So it should fulfill with both cases. You know, therefore, it should get material inserted into that shrinked pulp cavity of a very aged elephant, another 2-3 decades to make it a bubble or spherical shape material. But so to fulfill that, it is a very rare case in Sri Lanka. It's a very rare case in Sri Lanka if you fulfill both cases, because the both cases means to get aged over 75-70 years and also to get the material into that. Among Sri Lankan elephants, it's a very rare case because generally a lot of threats to Sri Lankan elephants. Generally, now at the time they're 30-40 years at the age, many of them may get poached or poisoned or nailed or give another blasting material like hakapattas. So many of them do not get proper age or do not die at the matured age in Sri Lanka. Therefore, general lifespan in wild elephants in Sri Lanka has been reduced very much in recent time. And also, we have about 150 tuskers in Sri Lanka, wild who are matured elephants, and also in captivity less than 10 tuskers to go in Perahera. So when we take the probability calculation, I done a calculation of the probability of the matured age and also to get that formation time and to get the material, everything, the fulfillment of the, all these requirements, the probability of Sri Lankan elephant is 0.001%. 0.001% is the probability to having an elephant pearl in Sri Lanka. If it is such formation, if it is formation, it the probability is very low because the age and other all the things to be fulfilled if it is forming such material. So therefore, it is very unlikely. But I don't say 100%. I don't say 100% no, but maybe a probability very, very rare, 0.001 probability is there. So in that case, so you will have to, so if you get a specimen, first of all, you will have to differentiate whether it's ivory material or other material. Because the present day, we get all these are ivory material made out of ivory. So the specimens, most of the time, they are pairs. So what if you see the police cases or the court cases recently in the media, you think you have noticed this. Many of them are identically weight, identical shape, and the appearance also same. And sometimes the presence of wax, dye, and oil, all these things. And other substitutes, there are many substitutes. Naturally born, teeth, shell, helmet, hornbill, the beak part, base of the beak, ivory palm, these are natural substitutes. And also artificially, there are resins, ivory dust, composites, resins, polyester, bakelite, there are natural artificial ivory also now produced. So in this case, you will have to realize if you get an specimen, how can it be? What is the possibility to having a Kajimuthi in this case? So that is the thing, so you can differentiate if it is ivory to go how this can be. So this some of the museum specimens, not all national museum specimen. If you see the sets scored by the police or some other investigations officers, so all this is the pairs. Even the customs, all these are pairs. How can it be? They are identical weight, shape, and the appearance. If it is naturally formed, if it is formed naturally within tusk, how can it be two identical objects naturally? It's very unlikely. That is the main thing you will have to observe if you get a specimen. How can the natural specimen be identical if they form in two different places or even within the same tusk? It is not possible. So if you, so that is a very important factor you will have to realize. How can a naturally formed items, formed items are identical? So if you can see those specimens anywhere who are having the properties, private properties or in museums. So even customs museum, there's a pair in the display. You can see those. So they are identical. So that is a very important factor. You can, differentiate. So that is, then it, of course, that means, so it, this is a very unlikely having a such elephant pearl-like object, but I'm not, we can't say 100% no, but possibility is there, where, but it's a very rare case. Therefore, be careful. All the time you get this manufactured ivory, basically tumble piece of ivory you get in the market. But I saw this many TV news in Sri Lanka. All of these are tumble piece of ivory. So the other material, Walampuri, here is different. I don't say no. There is, I have seen, but very, very, very rare. So this is also basically, it called, the concha. This is chank. Or in shank in India, chank. Was a specific term, specific conch of the species terminal. Any single valve gastropod is the conch. Conch means single bell gastropod. But there's a particular type of conches, it called chank or shank. This is even in customs classification. There's a special subheading in Sri Lanka that's for the chank. This special type of conches. It's with the species of Turbinella pyrum. So, Walampori is the specimen of a chank, it means Turbinella pyrum, with anti-clockwise turn. Generally, all the Turbinella pyrum specimens having the spiral goes, you know, clockwise. But Walampore is a mutant, natural mutant, very rare natural mutant, which are having anti-clockwise turn. And this is found only in Northern Indian Ocean, from Myanmar to Sri Lanka area. The Turbinella pyrum we see in this area, Myanmar to Sri Lanka, the North Indian Ocean. Dakshinavarti shank, according to the Wikipedia, that is the Indian term. And generally the inner lip of the shank or the chank get the orange or orange-brown color. Many other specimens of the Turbinella pyrum get the green or brown or light color. But specifically this particular specimens having dark orange color. This mutant gets, I don't know why, but this orange color is there. But time by time it could be faded away because all the color of the seashells get fed to the sunlight. But anyway, generally if it refreshes more orange, it is not found in other Turbinella pyrum specimens. That is very particular. So, and also I have to tell that I have examined several, not millions, several billions during my service, because generally we export in Sri Lanka 7-8 containers of chanks to various countries. So, in my subject, handle this subject, for several years and years, I have examined thousands, not millions, billions of shells. But I have seen only one so far, only one of the particular mutant Turbinella pyrum, that is Walampore. I have examined only one so far. So here, this is ordinary chank. So you get the opening here, and you can see the spiral to the clockwise spiral. And here you can see the real Walampore, this actual one. You know, you can see the spiral here. Spirals come to the anti-clockwise. The mouth, you know, it's the, when you had put when you keep the end to the mouth side, you had, can get the right arm in that. That is different. And the orange color lip and a slightly curved and the distorted than the normal one. So this you can see the both. This is the actual one, real Walampore, and the ordinary one. The white color, of course, this is when you remove the crust, you get the pure white. That is the white out of white, most white object in the world. In Sinhalese, it called Saksudakse, so white. There's no other object compared to that white. It's pure white. And that Walampore is here, and other chanks, and this is the fake one, busy conch. So, generally, widely in Sri Lanka, there are many things in the sale, especially the lightning whelk or the busy conch. And some, I have gone to the temples and the covils and many places, most of the time they are fakes. Sometimes the plaster of Paris, sometimes normal chanks, sometimes composite conches manufactured, and the Triton shells also. So they are keeping as Walampore and selling also. So that this is lightning well. This is a well-known sale in the media, you know, the television, some people. So that is lightning well or the busy conch. This is found in the West Atlantic. It means in West Indies, Bahamas, this area, West Indies countries. You get this shell, always it is anti-clockwise. It is not a mutant. That particular species always having the anti-clockwise. So therefore, people in Sri Lanka, they are selling and get caught as Valampuri because they think when they are anti-clockwise turn, it is always a Valampuri. See, but the shape is very different. You see this, this is like, that is the original one. It's like a ball, you know, very circular, like, you know. But this is very elongated. See, this American one, West Indies, is very elongated and polished. They are selling you big amount, several millions, small specimen. But they are no value at all. Or actually, these are fake. Fake means the natural thing. But that is always, you know, though it is natural thing, but this is not the Valampuri. So the other one is selling is the Triton conch. That is a different type of specimen. That is a rare specimen in Sri Lanka. Theronia tritonis is a rare and protected in Sri Lanka because a very rare and very big one and high value because a rare specimen. But it's not Valampuri. But I saw many cases. Even the few months back, I saw in the media, the police make some cases produced to the courts as Valampuri, misdescribing them as Valampuri. Okay? But they are not. This is the shell. This triton, very thin, and different species. These are not Valampuri or not Hagedi or the conches. Or the, sorry, chanks. But it's a conch, not chank. So another information about this material is the what I said is what we are exporting. Containers and contain lot of these chanks to Bangladesh, that is to manufacture the wedding or the traditional wedding jewelry in Bangladesh. We had this trade for even before BC 400 2200 BC. We had this trade, we carved chanks and exported, but we don't have this technology now. We can't make jewelry. We had this technology several years back, several thousand years back. And this is the jewelry. Now we do export and they manufacture these bangles for the wedding ring, necklace or a bangle for the traditional wedding jewelry in Bangladesh. So that is another use in the jewelry trade. You have to know it's out of chank, but these are not Valampuri case. This is also the present use of this, basic use of the chank. But many of us are not aware of this fact, why they are using this. But many things because of the Valampuri we are using. But Valampuri is a very, very rare case. For my whole life, I have seen only one in my service. So this is what I want to talk. Thank you.
So now I am handing over the session to Mr. Samitali Arge, our General Secretary, to deliver the vote of thanks. Yes, Mr. Samitali, it is the chance for you.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Rohan. Firstly, I would like to thank Mr. Samantha Gunasekara for giving us this interesting presentation and giving us a vast knowledge about this subject, Valampuri and elephant pearl. Thank you very much, sir. And secondly, I would like to thank all my colleague EXCO members and all GSL members who support us to make this event a success. Thank you very much. And also, I'm very much thankful for all the other gem and jewelry related associations who helped us to promote this event. Actually, there were a lot of associations who circulated our event in their membership. And I saw a very high demand and like very enthusiastic set of associations with us. I'm really thankful for you all, and I hope to see your cooperation in upcoming events of GSL as well. Thank you very much. So last but not least, I would like to thank everyone who joined to this session, especially including foreign participants as well. So we value your participation a lot. Thank you very much. And I hope to see you all in upcoming events of our association, upcoming knowledge sharing sessions also. So thank you very much. And I wish you all a nice day and stay safe. Thank you.